Is that thing you give your own prescription? $30 for 3 pairs. So, I only really need them for poorly lit papers. I inherited good vision from my parents. Bad teeth and good vision.
The clicker? Clicker? Do you need it?
I don't normally use it actually. Thanks. Yeah, okay. I saw one there, but.
Yeah.
Do you use a clicker, Dean? I don't normally myself.
Not normally.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. Yeah.
It's also a mouse pointer if you want.
Oh, true. Yeah.
Do you want it?
Not a mouse pointer, it's a laser pointer.
Okay.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
That belongs to this one?
Yes.
That's how it works. Are we using the? Can I switch it over?
Yes. Do you need audio? Do you have any video?
No.
Okay.
No.
So I just have to turn it on.
Okay, working.
Yeah, that can be handy if you don't want
to. So please remember to go with your. Presentation to the previous room.
Okay.
Well, I gave it already.
Okay.
Morning, yeah. Welcome, everyone.
Thanks for getting up early first thing Monday morning to come.
Feels a little funny starting the Inspire conference, but this is the first workshop, the first session, and we should all get a prize for being here on time, 9:00 Monday morning. Yeah. So, yeah, before we get started, thanks to the organizers here at in Barcelona. My name's Ken Bragg. I work for Safe Software.
And I'm Dean Hintz, also working for Safe. I'm based in Vancouver, and Ken is based here in, not here, but next door in France.
Yeah.
So I'll let Ken get started.
Yeah, I noticed there wasn't any coffee out yet, so we are here for 90 minutes, so if you do need to sneak out and grab a coffee, that's gonna be totally fine. So so we're talking about how to leverage available Inspire data. These are the challenges that we want to try to address this morning. So these are the problems that we want to look at, sort of how to solve. Dean and I have wanted to talk about this for a while because our company has been really focused on helping people create Inspire data, helping people create Inspire data services. But we realized that our software is actually very useful for taking advantage of Inspire information and making it usable. So some of the things that we want to get at here, how can anybody access Inspire data? So we have all these services available, how can we take advantage of that? What are the things that get in the way? And I think probably all of you sort of are familiar with some of the things that get in the way: complex schema, nested attributes, complex aggregate geometry. Some of these things are hard to deal with when you're working in more simple formats or more simple structures. What are some of the key workflows based on Inspire data? And we have 90 minutes, so we're open to a bit of a discussion about what some of the challenges you might face when working with Inspire information. Anything you want to add to that, Dean? Or?
No, nothing other than just to reiterate your last point that we really do value your feedback, so hopefully there'll be time towards the end, or even if, as we transition between me and Ken and I, if there's a burning question that you have, feel free to raise a hand.
So just quickly, the agenda here, there's really going to be four sections in the middle. Dean's going to talk about how to use our software to read Inspire GML and Inspire raster coverages. So just some of the tricks there of reading in this GML. That can be sort of a complicated workflow, but the goal here is to make it simple. That's what we're talking about. Next section, I'm going to talk about how to access some of the web services, WFS, WMS, the Atom download service, how to take advantage of some of these web services. After that, I'm going to talk a little bit about how to access Inspire data within ArcGIS using the data interoperability extension or the FME extension, which are really the same software underneath. Then Dean's going to talk about making Inspire information transparent, so how to create services for your users or for your customers that use Inspire information, but sort of in a transparent, more accessible way. So that's kind of where we're heading. Just quickly, what is FME? So the main product that we're going to be talking about today is FME. That's our product. FME is software that lets you transform data, hopefully to use it and hopefully to share it. So FME's been around since 1997, and we're focused on moving data between different formats, different systems, transforming it, making it as usable as possible. So that's really what FME is about. Mostly, we define workflows in FME Workbench. So this is the main product. It's advancing on its own. This is the main product that we work in to define data transformations is FME Workbench. And generally, we're reading from some system, reading feature types represented on the left by the brown boxes. We're transforming data with transformers. These are the blue building blocks. And then we're writing out data into another system or into another format, into the structure that you want your data to be in. So that's what FME is. Just to introduce it. One of the things that we try to focus on, and we are, FME is proprietary software, you have to buy FME, but we really try hard to support open standards and to support free and open software. So Safe Software is sponsoring some open source projects that we take advantage of, we contribute back to the community, but more importantly, we try to be a bridge between some of these proprietary systems and some more open standards and open formats. This is something that we really try to focus on at SAFE, is making a bridge between different data systems, helping people implement open standards in their organization. So, hi Mark. So this is something that we try to do. When it comes to what we call the full Inspire lifecycle, as I said, we were kind of focusing on helping people create Inspire information, but we could look at this as a life cycle for an organization that has to meet Inspire requirements. We could talk about evaluating what needs to be provided, assembling data to be delivered to the Inspire specification, transforming information, transforming the schema, the geometry, possibly the format, into what's required, writing Inspire GML, creating web services, validating Inspire information, seeing if it's valid, if it's complete, and then publishing it out. So we could think of FME kind of plays a role in all of these steps. We're really focusing today more on the taking advantage of it part. We're focusing on reading it, making use of it, how you can leverage FME to take advantage of Inspire information. So just kind of listing the same things here. Talking about consuming Inspire information, that's what we're focusing on. But FME is a tool also for transforming data, validating data, and publishing it. So we're kind of involved in all these parts, I guess we could say. Yeah. So I think with that, I'm going to pass it over to Dean, who's going to talk about the first section here, reading Inspire GML and reading XML.
Before I get right into it, just so I understand you as an audience a little bit better, how many of you use FME from time to time? Okay, so the rest of you are relatively new, so you shouldn't necessarily assume that you know what FME is. Now, Ken gave a good intro of that, but basically FME, you could think of it as sometimes some people use a term spatial ETL. So it's a way of defining workflows that help you integrate and load data into your system. So I'm going to dive right in and talk about how do you consume Inspire data. One thing we found fairly early on was that in the realm of Inspire, at least from our experience, there were actually more servers than there were clients. Like, everybody had to get an Inspire service up, so they would stand it up, and actually, they would have a custom client that they would use to test their own, but not many people were actually trying to integrate across all these different services. So obviously, over time, this validation has become more important. There are a lot more people consuming, but I think even in conferences like this, by and large, the emphasis has been on production over consumption. So that's something that we were addressing here. So I'm going to talk briefly about, open up a few data sets and talk about our inspection tools, and then a little bit on transformation. So I guess ultimately for Inspire to meet its goals of making data more shareable and accessible, we do ultimately need to be results oriented. So it's one thing for those of us in the room who are sort of data or GIS analysts to be able to use Inspire data. But ultimately, I think Inspire is not going to be successful unless there are people using the data that don't even know it's Inspire. They're just consuming services that are out there. And we want to be able to support that as much as possible. Now, quickly on Data Inspector, you could think of Data Inspector, that's our viewing tool in FME, and it supports a wide range of data types, everything from vector to raster, 3D, and certainly all of the different Inspire themes. But just to maybe change gears, in case some of, actually one other quick question, who was at the workshop last year that we did? Okay. Not too big an overlap. I thought just a quick change of gears, I would show you something that we've done. A lot of, obviously, Inspire is built on open standards and OGC standards specifically. And so we've invested quite a bit of time and effort to make FME support open standards better. So here's an example of how we can read XML directly. In the past, if you wanted to read XML, you'd have to open it up in an XML editor first and figure out how you're going to parse it. So in this case, I'm just going to drag the data onto Inspector, and I'm choosing XML. And we have a new control here. It's like a tree type control. And so you can basically navigate through the data and pick the items that you want to make into a feature type. So I've picked those two. I'll go one level deeper. So the basic challenge both with GML and XML is that it's essentially sort of an object-oriented data structure, and most GIS systems are relational or flat. And so reconciling that fundamental difference in the data models can be a bit tricky. I think I'm going to need a different mouse pad. Okay, so right off the top here, there's a table view at the bottom as well. So you can see that we're reading in this data. So this is just the contact information. And the next one is a bunch of citation information. But I might want to go a bit deeper. And let's say that structure, drill into that structure a little bit more. And so this time, I'm going to go and get the extents. And the reason why I mention that is that there's a lot of metadata and catalog services out there, and what you could do with FME is you can actually use it to query those and get things like extents to drive an automated workflow. So I could have a system which would query metadata, get the extents, and then use that to actually issue a request for information. So I just wanted to highlight there's this functionality that FME has both with reading and writing XML. It's particularly, in the Inspire context, it's mostly around things like metadata, but it's also a lot of the web services are built on XML. So being able to, for example, issue a get capabilities request and parse the response, you need the XML tools for that. Okay, so I'll just keep moving along. So other times you might use the XML reader is sometimes there are hybrid forms of GML where it's embedded within XML. And also just for scraping web services like RSS and XML feeds. Now, diving into GML specifically, some of the issues around GML, obviously it's all about the schema. And so if there are any issues with schema, you can have trouble reading it. One of the main points is the last one is the namespaces. There's the version 3, version 4, and so if you have a schema document that doesn't line up with what's in the namespace header of the XML itself, then you can have trouble reading it. Then other things that can cause some grief are access orders. So if your data all ends off the African coast or Yemen somewhere, then maybe you've got the access order wrong. And I'll demo in a minute the bounded by, how to filter it out. So one of the issues the whole structure, of course, with Inspire is that it's such a rich data model, there are a lot of applications that have trouble dealing with that complexity. So being able to filter out parts you don't need and just keep what you do want. And here you can see there's the different namespaces on the right, so we support both, but you know, unfortunately, sometimes if you're not able to read it, you do have to dig in and look at that header and figure out, which is the right version for what you're reading. We have done a complete reorganization in FME 2016, so we've put the important parts like selecting application schema or themes at the top, and some of these more obscure settings that most people don't use that often, we've pushed them down to the bottom and hidden them away. So there's a lot of power in our GML reader, but we're trying to focus your attention on just on the stuff that you need the most. I think the best thing to do here is just run through a quick demo before I give it back to Ken. I'll just mention that, again, it's not just nested structures, there's also series. And so series in FME, we model them as lists. And in many cases, for example, just with geographic names, you can have multiple spellings. And the thing is inside the schema, anytime something is defined as being occurring one or more times, even if 99.5% of the time there's only one instance of that object, FME or most tools will treat it as a list. And so what you can do with FME is just grab the first one. So just to be pragmatic. And there's always this tension when working with Inspire data. Do you want to be sort of religiously conformant to the schema? And if you're providing a service that has to validate against the schemas, maybe you need to do that. Or are you loading into your database or your GIS, in which case you're mostly focused on the data itself and not preserving that structure. Yeah, I think I covered most of these, so I'll just run through a quick demo. Got lots of interesting data sets here, but for now, So I would like to have spent a bit more time in different types of data. For example, we had different raster data sets, but for now we're going to go off to Helsinki and look at some administrative units data. I can't remember if Ken mentioned it, but FME does support about 350 formats, so it is quite easy for you to combine data, both proprietary data and open source data. So we'll see what happens here. Turn the log back on. We try to be very informative in the logs, so some, you know, if there's lots of red, then you better look out. Now the challenge here is that is this complex geometry, and the issue is that if I click on that polygon, and the issue would be if you try to bring this into a GIS like ArcGIS, for example, you might only see a box, and you don't get to see the data underneath because there's multiple geometries in Inspire. And so the first one that shows up is this bounded by, and that's useful for metadata because you have a little square saying, you know, where that data lies. But if you just want to get the line work underneath, it can obscure it. And so to get around that problem, I'll just go ahead and add it again, and this time I'm going to say properties to ignore, bounded by. So that's one of those, we have, because of the complexity of the GML reader, we have a lot of options. A lot of them are hidden because we don't use them as often. They're not hidden, but they're in those little collapsed arrows, so you just have to open that up. So it'll go away and pull in that data. And hopefully it will ignore the that extra geometry. Now there are other ways of getting rid of it. Now you can see it's a nice clean set of polygons without the bounded bys. In fact, it got rid of them both for administrative units as well as for the administrative boundaries. And you can go in here and see. And that's the other power of the inspection tool, is it's not meant to be a GIS. I mean, we work with GIS data, but we're not, our primary purpose with our tools are not to make pretty maps. The primary purpose is to give you full access to your data. And so you can see the richness of the attribute model with all the list structures around the, you know, geographic names. And then you can also see the model of the geometry. And it's still a multi-part geometry, but the bounded by part has been removed. And I've got a lot more other demos, but if you're interested, if you have a specific data set that you have a challenge with, please do come by our booth, or you can talk to us afterwards and we can show you some other examples or look at your data. Okay, a couple of other things. Just some tips and tricks for workarounds. If you had been here last year, I demoed an XML reader. That the cool thing with FME is its flexibility. It's very flexible tool. So you can kind of prototype and game things, and so you can take an existing reader and make your own custom reader or writer out of it. And so that's what I did with the XML reader, is I added some logic to it that. So it would basically look for an element type that you specify, and then it would scan them for GML objects and suck them in the case when you didn't have a schema. And now that's actually been rolled into the product, so now the regular GML reader has this ignore schema option. And where this came up is we had a lot of support requests saying, well, QGIS could read this, why can't you? And our response was, well, QGIS is making a mistake by letting you read that because it doesn't conform to the schema. But most people didn't care whether or not QGIS was respecting the schema. They just wanted to see the data. And so that's why we added this option.
Actually, the other place, when reading GML and FME, the other time that ignores schema is useful is if you don't have an internet connection. Because often schemas need to be resolved through web connections, and then we can't read them. So you check ignore schema. FME doesn't try to resolve all the schema, but we can still read the GML without an internet connection.
Yeah.
That comes up as well.
And I don't know if you're going to demo that at all on the WFS side, because I don't.
Right.
Yeah, if we have time.
The other thing I'm going to mention on WFS, just in terms of reading in general, like I said, we report a lot of detailed information in the logs, and so often people will have trouble with the web service, and they'll think it's the software tool they're using, but we provide you with the URLs in the log. You can click on that from your web browser, and that will tell you, can the browser actually see the service or not? And then you'll know, is it a software problem or a communication problem?
So isolating problems is always a challenge.
A couple of other new points for things that are new. So there's the ignore schema setting right at the top. And if you turn that on, ignore schema, then you actually have to tell FME, well, what's the container? Because if you're ignoring the schema, you have to tell how to slice up the XML. And then so you can come up with alternate containers. It could be member or it could be anything. It could be generic city objects if you wanted to use that to chop up city GML. And the other thing we did that's new is there are different containers for the whole data set. So something new I learned this year is that the standard is that it should be a WFS feature collection, not a GML feature collection, even though both are supported. So we've abstracted our container model so we can handle any type of container. So here's just a few shots of what you've already seen, some other types of data. And maybe the last thing I'll do before I pass it back to Ken is I'll pop up this 3D buildings data set. And again, we don't have time to demo all this stuff, but validation is an important thing as well. Sometimes we'll get data from customers. One of the first things I do, if they are complaining, why can't I read this data? Well, I'll run through and do a syntax check on it, or I'll check it against the Inspire schemas, and if it comes back with a big long error list, well, it saved me a lot of work trying to configure FME to read it when it wasn't valid to begin with. And then I think I'll leave Ken to talk about loading data into GIS and working with ArcGIS. But that's obviously a key workflow, both loading to GIS and extracting from. And in terms of integrating with other data, obviously you want to be able to expose deep within that structure. You want to make sure you're preserving things like feature IDs so you can link data together and build relationships, either by ID or spatially. And FME also, we don't have time to get into it today, but we support, 5,000 odd coordinate systems, and you can define your own. So that's another issue with data integration, is getting everything in a common spatial reference. And for 3D data, you have to be able to do that relative to the geoid, so full 3D reprojection. So this is just a snapshot of sort of the nested versus relational. So schema mapping, I would say that's a big chunk of your work if you're doing data integration between Inspire and an internal system. You have to reconcile that difference in schema. So there's really no shortcut to this part. I don't know if we'll hear from Kintera, but they have Inspire solution pack, which makes that process a little bit easier. But ultimately, you need to know your data in order to do that schema mapping. And we've got tons of examples. Some of these are available online for things like loading and extracting from databases. This is what in FME, those little boxes that you'll see in some of our upcoming demos.
So just doing that schema mapping. And the whole goal is with one of our central goals in FME is to enable you to have full control over your data without having to write any code.
Can you go back two slides?
This one?
Yeah, I just want to highlight, because you know, we've kind of gotten fairly far along without talking too much about Workbench, but that's a fairly typical workflow in FME where Dean's reading some feature type protected sites, doing some transformation with transformers, and then writing it out to whatever. That could be file geodatabase, it could be shape, I don't know what the writer is in that. It is geodatabase.
Yeah.
So that's a pretty typical workflow where we're transforming Inspire GML into a geodatabase. Some organizations want to maintain Inspire information for their area and the surrounding areas, so they read from the web services perhaps, and load into their own geodatabase.
And also, obviously, Inspire is very schema heavy, so you may have, 100 or more fields or elements on a feature, and maybe only 5% of those actually have values that you care about in your database. So the first step here is removing the attributes that you don't need, and the second one is resolving a list structure. So maybe it's just indexing out the first element in the list. And then the last one is what I showed you on the previous slide with that schema mapping from in this case from the Inspire schema to the GIS. And the nice thing about Data Inspector is you can actually drop in these inspection points anywhere in your data flow and see what is the data model doing at that time. Because it can be, with these complex data models, it can be pretty hard, your output doesn't have the field value, where did I lose it? And so being able to inspect at any point certainly helps. And one thing you'll notice when we're reading straight from the GML, you'll see that we use a parent.child notation as a representation of the object model. Okay, we have more. I've got more stuff later that I'll get on to. I just wanted to, just as I hand it over here to Ken, I'll just show you one other quick data set. So, and again, all I have to do here is pick the theme. In this case, it's buildings 3D. You have to actually flip to 3D mode, and then you can kind of zoom in and pan around. And we're not just displaying the 3D objects, but we're also getting the entire model within it. And it's all georeferenced. Yeah, so just to sum up, basically FME supports all aspects of consuming XML, GML, and then didn't really have time to get too much into it, but different coverages, whether it's raster or point coverages, anything like that. Getting full control over the transformation step is really key to leveraging the Inspire data in your system, so you have full control over how the feature types are composed, the data structures, and whether it's the attribute model or the geometry model. And I think we've certainly made this transition. It used to be when you were working with GML and XML and FME, you had to be more of an XML expert than a data expert. Now, you really just need to know your data. You can let us worry about how to keep up with the standards and
XML stuff. Okay, so off to web services.
So yeah, we just have to do two transitions today. So I'm going to talk, changing gears slightly, just talking about how to use FME to access data that's in web services. Some of these web services, the WFS web service and the Atom web service, we tend to be working with GML anyway, but we're getting it from web services. The first one, FME has a WMS reader. Now that probably seems kind of strange. WMS is a web service that's intended for viewing information, and organizations put a lot of effort into creating WMS services that look, that maybe look nice or meet the standard for the representation. We can in FME read WMS and we get raster features and then translate that into something else. So we do sometimes get people using FME to read from a WMS web service and create sort of a tiled raster data set. Now that's maybe not an ideal workflow if you're the organization that's providing that web service to have someone pulling all these tiles out. There's maybe a better way to deliver that information, but it is possible. So we support WMS 1.1, 1.3, and we support the time thing in WMS as well. So just a quick example of what that can look like. So here's FME Workbench. Actually, that's the wrong workspace. It's this one. Really complicated workspace, but we've got a WMS reader in here, and the source data set in FME is just the URL to the get capabilities point. We can take a quick look at it. This is from a municipality in the UK, and this particular feature type is wildlife corridors. So I can just click on the data inspector here. We can have a look at that looks like. So there it is. It's not a particularly complicated raster image. This is just the tile that we get by default without sending any bounding box. So with FME, we can send bounding box on the request. We can send resolution. That's obviously limited by the web service. But we do get a raster. I'm displaying that with the background map, our data inspector's background map, just so we can see it. And we can just turn some transparency on to this raster just to see what that looks like. A bit too much. So I'm showing the output from that WMS service, that's a raster feature, on top of the background map. So in a workspace, and this is about as simple as it gets, I can translate that into a JPEG, for example. So that's what this workspace looks like, not complicated at all. So I just run this, it reads from the web service, so it's prompting me where is the web service you want to read from, and it writes the JPEG out. Now that particular one, it's just one, it's not a particularly big area, so we can kind of get everything in one request. But you'll see that in the reader, we have the opportunity to set the width and the height and the search envelope. So all of this is configurable, and we see workflows where people parameterize a workspace and run it multiple times to get different areas of interest that they're after. So that's WMS, not particularly exciting, but just to keep in mind it is possible. If we switch over to WFS, so that's the Inspire web service that delivers GML as a web service, these are vector features. So that's a little more interesting. It's probably, actually I'm not really sure, but if I had to guess, I would say it's probably the most common Inspire download service type out there right now. So FME can read WFS features, which are vector features, and translate them into any format that we support. So that's quite a few different formats. We're supporting 1.1, 2.0, and Dean went to a lot of effort to get our developers to support paging in the WFS service. So this is the idea that it's not possible to get all of the data at once. That's too big of a web request from this, from the organization that's serving it, so a workspace can be set up to read pages of the information at a time. So so we'll just look at a little demonstration here. And I think if I open that up. So I'm going to read, we're kind of jumping around the world as we demonstrate reading these different data sets. So this is another one from the UK. This is the North York Moors National Park Authority. Anybody from the UK in here right now? Do you know where that is? Is it a nice, seems like it's a nice place. There's a lot of green on the map. But so I'm going to read a few feature types from this web service. So data.gov.uk has nice kind of metadata set up. I can copy the link to their WFS endpoint there. And then an FME, we can read it. And I actually wanted to demonstrate this part, so I'm not going to delete that. And I'll add it in again. So again, not a very complicated workspace. I had already set this one up to read from, and again, it's the get capabilities endpoint. This time, it's the WFS service. So that was my source data set parameter. Dean mentioned already that one of the challenges that we have is that we often get complex aggregated geometry that doesn't necessarily want to go into the format that you're trying to load that information into. So in this case, I'm writing into a file geodatabase, so I use a deaggregator transformer to deaggregate those polygons. So these are tree protection orders. This can be point data, and one of the feature types, this particular one is polygon data. So it's just that one feature type I'm reading here, tree protection orders, deaggregating it, writing it into a file geodatabase. So that's what's happening right now. I just started it running. There it goes. You'll also see the data inspector in there. Dean mentioned we can view the data at any point in a translation. So I sent the data to the data inspector and to the file geodatabase writer at the same time. And if I zoom in, we can see some of these tree protection area polygons that are in here. And you can see that these are, actually this particular one is just a polygon, but some of the features were complex geometry that we needed to deaggregate to put it in there. So to add a W, just to kind of back up a little bit and show the steps that I took to create that workflow, I add a WFS reader, paste the URL to the get capabilities endpoint, that's the URL that would be provided, into the dataset parameter. And then I click here to choose the feature type that I want to read from. So I can add in a different one. I'm going to add in conservation areas this time. Again, as Dean mentioned, there's some kind of similar to GML, because we are in essence reading GML. There are some more complex parameters in here. Some of them you may or may not need to use. One of them, for example, is max features. So that says I'm only going to read, what is that set to? Is that 30,000 features at once? I'm not going to try to read more than that. And this kind of comes to knowing most WFS web services have a limit on how many features you can read at a time. So we use the paging to get more information out of that. Again, we have the ignore application schema parameter. And then one that I often struggle with here is the access order. We can have, this is supposed to be covered by the coordinate system. So a WFS service, the coordinate system should define, does X come before Y? Have people dealt with this challenge? Anybody dealt with this challenge already? It can be painful. So in fact, last night we were looking at a data set that was supposed to be in the Czech Republic, and it was showing up in Yemen. Okay, I think that might be an access order problem. So if you run into that, you're reading information and you see it's really not in the right part of the world, that may be a tip that the access order is wrong, and you may need to set that. So it's 1-2 or 2-1, and then there's the third dimension as well. But I happen to know this one's, the default settings work here. So I'm just adding in another feature type to my workflow here. A second to read. So FME's getting the schema. So that's the schema from, and you can see, you know, there's a lot of attributes. This is where we get into the point about schema mapping here. I won't get into that right now. so I could make another destination geodatabase feature class. I won't go too far in here, but this, I would need to do some setting. I would need to set up the attributes in the destination feature class for this other feature type, but just to make the point here that I could read from now two feature types at the same time and write into two different file geodatabase feature classes. And that's the kind of thing that we're trying to do with the WFS reader, is make it possible for you to get at that information and do what you want with it. The last one that I'm going to talk about when it comes to web services here is the Atom RSS download services that we're seeing. And when this first started getting talked about, I thought, this is a really good way to do it. It does seem to be growing in popularity. So these are really web feeds that have links to zip files of Inspire data that you can download. So it may not be reading live from your database if you're providing that, but a lot of organizations have found ways to update these frequently enough. So I think it's a really good way to provide a data download service. Anybody doing this now, providing Atom download services too? Okay. So basically what we can do here, and I'm going to show this in a second, the Atom, you could think of it as it's like an RSS feed that has a bunch of links. So it's really a web page in a way that has links to zip files. How do we take advantage of that in FME? Well, we read the web service itself, we find out the links inside FME, we download the zip file, extract it, read out what's inside it, and translate it into something else. And this sounds complicated, but it actually isn't. And the data set I'm going to use for this, it's kind of interesting. This is, who's German in the room? Obviously Mark, Benjamin, and Soren. Okay, we have a couple of others. This is the state of Saxony, and this is some of their Inspire web services. Now, in fact, this data was prepared for this organization with the help of FME and the Inspire solution pack from Contera. Do you guys want to talk about that for a sec, or? Or not. It's first thing in the morning, it puts you on the spot. Contera, that's these guys. Guys, just put up your hands so they see who you are. They have a stand as well. So Contera is a safe software reseller in Germany, among other things. They have a stand. But Contera makes a product that integrates with FME called the Inspire Solution Pack that helps organizations prepare data for Inspire delivery. So these guys worked on this project, so this data was prepared with FME, and now we're going to read it with FME. It's a little bit incestuous, but it's a good example. So down here, we have a few links to these Atom download services, and one of them that I'm going to look at here is addresses by city. So each entry, each link, is all of the address points in a given city. And I find this is actually, you can look at this in Firefox. If you paste the link, so I just pasted the link there into Firefox. It's actually a bit easier to see it. In Chrome, it just looks like a bunch of XML. But if you paste this in Firefox, Firefox recognizes it as an RSS feed. So you'll see there's a bit of metadata here and a little image that shows what we're looking at. And then each of these is a link to a zip file. So it's a really user-friendly way of distributing Inspire data, I think. You download a zip file, and it's a zip file of GML. So how can we take advantage of this in FME? I'm just going to open up the workspace here. Where is it? Right here. So I mentioned that we read the web feed. Okay, so we're not reading data yet, really. We read the web feed. If I just open this in the data inspector, what we're reading in FME, you're just going to see a table with the links, which is kind of what we want to get at. This takes a second to open. Okay, so here it comes. Yeah, so it's reading the same thing. It's reading the same thing I showed in Firefox. It's really just reading that web page. So it's taking a second to come down. But each city has a link. There's the link to the zip file. Okay? So in FME, I could parameterize this, meaning I can let users choose which city they want the zip file from. And then the tester uses that parameter to just say, okay, I only want to read that one link for this city. Can somebody pronounce that? Altmetvida? No, yes? You can't read it, and what I said wasn't recognizable. Anyway, this is a city in Saxony, I guess. Probably not a very big one. And then we use a little trick. The HTTP fetcher is a transformer in FME that can read anything from any web service. It will download the zip file. And actually, I'll start this running right now. So we've pulled out just the one link that we want, the zip file. FME is going to download the zip file just into a temporary directory. We'll use the feature reader transformer to read the GML out of the zip file and then translate it into shapefiles. And I'm using what we call the dynamic schema mode in FME, meaning we'll just create a shapefile with whatever schema the GML had. So we're not trying to do any fancy schema mapping in this particular workflow. I just downloaded the zip file from the city, FME read the GML out of it, translated it into shape. And you can see over here the output that's happening here. Oh, no, I'm in the wrong directory. Adam, output. So here's where we downloaded the zip file. I'll just show you what's inside there. So that was the zip file that we unloaded, just a single GML file that came from that web service. And then FME translated these address points into actually four different shape files based on the feature types that were inside that GML file. So it's a way we can automate the use of the GML that's coming from this Atom feed. I'm actually talking specifically about this on Friday. It's funny, we're the very first presentation of the whole conference right now, and I'm also doing the very last presentation of the whole conference on Friday afternoon. So in that presentation, I'm going to look at an Atom feed created by the Danish Geodata Denmark and how they read from that, but they also use that source to find out if the data needs updated. So Geodata Denmark themselves read their own Atom feed, compare that to their production database, and they can tell if they need to do an update. So that's how that can be useful. That's, I think, all I want to say on these web services here. Any questions before I move on there? So we've basically read the parameter, which municipality, downloaded the link from the Atom feed, downloaded the zip file, unzipped the file, translated it into shape. So those were the three web services I want to cover. Obviously, some of these web services are just designed, you know, in ArcGIS, which I'm going to come to in a sec. You can just add web service and you can see it in ArcGIS. What we're adding to this is the ability to transform this and translate it into something else. Okay, so the next topic here. Oops, it's been open already. Just going to get a drink of water. I'm supposed to be done at 10 after. How to take advantage of some of this stuff inside ArcGIS. And I know not everybody here is necessarily ArcGIS users, but we do know that a lot of the Inspire community is working with ArcGIS products. So Esri sells a product called the Data Interoperability Extension. This is actually FME sold and branded by Esri. That, by default, even at no cost, includes our WFS reader in it. So what I showed you with reading from WFS, you can do that inside ArcGIS. That's actually part of the data interoperability extension is free, the part that reads WFS. If you purchase the interoperability extension, we get some other things that we can use. We can connect to any data source that FME can read within ArcGIS, and we can create what's called a spatial ETL tool, which is, guess what, a workspace. So these are the things I'm going to show just really quickly here before I pass it back to Dean. So if we open up our catalog here, you'll see at the bottom, so in our catalog, if you have the data interoperability extension, even I can't say it, that will show up in your extensions. Where I have right now the FME extension for ArcGIS installed, because I have FME installed. If you've bought the interoperability extension, it will show up in the same place and it will work almost exactly the same way. So it whichever one we're talking about, they're both FME, they both kind of show up in the same way. So one of the things that you get here is, down at the bottom, add an FME connection, or if it was the interop extension, it would say add an interoperability connection. And you can click on that and add in any data source that FME can read. So you can take advantage here of any of this Inspire reading stuff that we've been talking about. So here I pasted in the same URL for the York Moors National Park. I think I've called that wrong. What was it called again? Somebody remember. It was the York, North York Moor. Is that it? Thank you. North York Moor. I can choose the same feature types, and I can read them into ArcGIS like this. Once you've done that, so there it is down at the bottom, I have these feature types. Once you've done that, these can be dragged into ArcMap. You can save them out of ArcMap into a file geodatabase or do whatever you want with them. So that's one way to access this stuff. The other way, which is more powerful but a little bit hidden, if you create your own toolbox, so you need your own toolbox for this, you can create a new FME ETL tool or a new spatial ETL tool if you have the data interop extension, and that creates an FME workspace that's inside ArcGIS. So I created one already that's reading this check parcel data that I talked about that had the access order reversed. So I'll just open that up and we'll take a look. So we can create a workspace within ArcGIS if you have the data interoperability extension. So interop. We all call it interop, but because none of us can say it either. This was a funny thing. The acronym for it would be DIE, but that's absolutely not allowed to call it that. So here it is. It looks just like FME Workbench. I'm reading here three feature types from this Czech Inspire data source that I think, did you find that on the Inspire Geo portal? Or the Inspire data, the EU data portal. Is that where you found that? Yeah. But you can see here I had to set the access order to 1-2 because this was the data that showed up in Yemen by mistake. And I'll just run this. And this is just reading that GML information, translating it into a file geodatabase. So we're using FME, but we're actually within ArcGIS here. So it's kind of the same workflow. In this case, again, I just used a deaggregator to break up the features and let the schema, we let FME recreate the schema in the geodatabase that matched the GML as closely as possible. So we didn't try to do any schema mapping. That's a whole nother topic that we could talk about for probably another hour and a half. So the numbers are how many features are passing through each feature type. So we're seeing it. So there was quite a few cadastral boundaries. I think we can preview this here. Did I have it? Yeah, I think it's right here. Yeah, this is the data here in ArcGIS. So I had made another FME connection just so we could view that data, but this is the data that I'm actually translating now. So it's a bunch of cadastral polygons. So I think that's all I wanted to say there about reading from the web services and then about accessing some of these capabilities inside ArcGIS. So I'll pass it back to you here, Dean, I think. And this is the last computer switch we have to make.
Thanks, Ken. You actually gave me even a couple more, one or two more minutes. That's good.
Never a good idea.
Well, we'll try to leave at least a couple minutes for questions at the end. Okay, so what is all this that at the outset we had some objectives or challenges, and one of them was, well, how can we make data a little more friendly for the average, what we might call the average Joe or Jane, the typical user out there that doesn't necessarily, hasn't been to the Inspire training courses. So I picked some decidedly low-tech solutions at the top, KML and PDF. You know, you could probably send a PDF to your grandma and she can open it, or, you know, on a cell phone or on a tablet. And KML, I think, well, at some point you could drag KML into Google Maps just in a browser. I'm not sure you'd still do that. So that's the top two, and I've got examples for all these. I'm going to probably run out of time, but whatever I don't get to during today's session, you could drop by the booth, and we'll probably end up publishing a few more examples online. We have a lot of examples. We have a whole Inspire tutorial. So the second point is web services. So we're talking today a lot about GML, because that's a lot of the standards are based on that, but not a lot of clients that on your mobile phone are going to be able to work with Gmail. So typically for mobile devices, they're going to be based on web services, sort of like a tile server, and that's like taking that vector data and rasterizing it in some way, styling it, and then producing a web service. And then JSON feeds. Sometimes you don't necessarily want a map back. You might just want some data or some, you know, a distance measurement or something. And so JSON could come back as GeoJSON if you want to have geometry in it, or it could just be straight up JSON. So I'll look at some examples of that. This is protected sites up in Sweden, converted over to KML. And here are some 3D data rendered in Google Earth. But I think rather than look at slides, I'm going to pop up. With the mouse, I'm going to try using this paper instead. Maybe it's just my mouse is on the blink. Yeah. Okay, so I had that buildings data set you saw earlier, and what I'm going to do is pop up.
So where's that from, the buildings data set?
Well, that is from Holland, and it was ultimately generated out of CityGML. Truth be told, but anyway, here pop-up workbench. So I'm going to make a new workspace. Don't worry, it's pretty simple. So one way to do it, you can just drag the data in there, and you get a dialog, Inspire. You saw this dialog before when I put it in the data inspector. So that's a typical workflow. It's always a good idea to actually look at what's in your data before you try to do a lot of transformation. That's the other big support request we get. Oh, what's wrong with my output? Why doesn't FME generate output? Well, if the input data is not what you expect, then you probably won't get the output you want. So I just chose a 3D buildings, and in this case, I only want the building part. So there's lots of filtering going on. Then the next thing I'm going to do is a attribute remover. And all in this case, if you open this up, it's just a massive list. I'm not going to zoom out because it's going to take me a few minutes to get back. It's just a lot of fields. And so I'm doing a select all. You can see this tree view. So we're implementing this tree idea in other places in our user interface because it's a lot easier to work with than just an endless list of fields. And so once I've done that, now I have a manageable list of fields. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a 3D PDF writer. I'll just put PDF in. Write that in there. buildings.pdf. And I'll put manual for schema for now, because I'm just going to copy it from. So I'm going to hook these up. Right now there's no fields, so I'm just going to right click and go copy them from the previous transformer. And then I can pop that up and see what fields got added. About 20 odd fields. And that's pretty much it. So then I'm going to go ahead and run that. So I built a workflow in just like a couple minutes. Pop that up, and then I have to. A second to come up, and then I'm a little challenged without my mouse. I don't know why it doesn't work that well. Now the cool thing about this is it's not just a pretty picture 3D, but the actual feature table is preserved as well. And so I can go in here and click on different elements and actually see the Inspire IDs and let's say that lifespan number, so I can actually see, well, that building, that data came from this time period. So even though this is very low tech, this is just PDF, now you've taken this complex Inspire data, simplified it, and you could actually build a streaming service that would, so this could open up within a web page. So it doesn't even have to be a desktop application. Yeah, there's no plug-in there. I'm having some trouble with my.
No.
There's the I think GeoPDF is an extra cost thing. There's a geospatial PDF which is 2D. This is 3D PDF, but we support both. You could do either. The geospatial PDF is more suitable for like a 2D map rendering. And this is obviously better for 3D data.
At the moment in FME, it's two different writers.
Yeah.
GeoPDF and 3DPDF, which is, we want to bring them into a single writer with the option to do 3D, but that's the way it is now.
Yeah. Okay, so that was my first attempt at being client-friendly. And the next one, I'll pop up. In this case, I'm not going to rebuild the workflow. It's a little bit longer. But I'll show you what the workspace looks like, and then I'll run through a quick demo. So this is the one that's generating KML. And right off the top, this is a bit odd, because where is the data coming from? So we have, and I think, I'm not sure if your Atom Feed one was the same. Did it start with a creator? So FME stands for Feature Manipulation Engine, so it's feature driven. And normally you have a data set that gets things going, let's say a row and a table. But in some cases, we don't have anything to start with, so we just kick it off with what's called a creator. And what this does is it actually gets a bounding box, and then it uses that to provide a window that we want to get data from. So the bounding box, and if I go in here, you can see these are actually dynamic. They're provided by the user. And so the user provides the extent. That makes a polygon. That goes to the feature reader. And Ken showed this earlier. It's very powerful because what it does is it, instead of making one workflow, you can have a workflow that generates other workflows. So it's like a meta workflow. And in this case, what it's doing is it's taking these extents and firing them off to a WFS server. And the whole point of, well, why would I bother doing that? What I'm trying to do here is to abstract the WFS service. So basically, we're having a wrapper around the WFS service so that somebody who doesn't understand WFS, in this case, it's going to be Google Earth, can talk to the WFS service. So Google Earth just says it doesn't understand all of the OGC stuff. It just knows what extents it wants. That comes into this workspace, gets translated into a WFS request. The WFS server then transmits the data back, and then this translates that Inspire Gmail into KML that Google Earth can understand. So again, actually quite low tech. This is the typical stuff here going on, removing attributes we don't need. Here we are extracting that big long geographic name into a simple name that we can use in KML, and then some styling specific to KML. So you can see the spelling of name text and Inspire local ID. So I can run that, but I'm too lazy to do that, so I'm just going to go here, and I'm going to go to Barcelona and see what happens. So what this is supposed to do, now this is one, what you could say, kind of eating your own dog food. I've got a WFS server on FME server, which serves up airports. Then I have this wrapper server talking to that WFS server and the client. So this is really a bad idea when you're doing demos. It's kind of high risk because everything's on one poor little notebook. But it seems to be working. So where did Barcelona go? Somewhere in here. Yeah. So that's the actual air transport network. Airport nodes. And so you can see it's actually got a lot of the Inspire models preserved. The stuff that you're probably interested in is the name of the airport and the code, the ICOA code, which is BCN. So like where I'm from, Vancouver, that would be YVR. And so that's not, it's not exactly pretty, but it just goes to show that what we've done is we've taken an Inspire WFS and overlaid it with essentially a broker service in FME server, and then allowed that to have Google Earth talk to that intermediary. And so this now makes that those specialized Inspire services consumable by Google Earth. And as everybody knows, Google Earth's all over the place. So a lot more people can get at it than if we just said, no, you got to go buy FME and use Data Inspector to see that data. Now anybody with Google Earth can look at it. And we're not just preserving a bunch of points. You've got all that underlying data model in there, too, that you can pretty up and style. Again, we don't produce end results. We give you guys the tools to do that. So I thought that was a fun one. And I couldn't leave well enough alone, so then I actually had to take the same workspace, and all I did was change the writer. So this took, to be honest, I did this morning just to see if I could do it. And so what I made was a JSON service. So it's essentially fairly close to, you could call it like a RESTful service. And so it looks almost exactly the same, except, I didn't bother getting rid of the stylers. That stuff is not really used. But now we're not going to use this to consume. This is not going to support Google Earth. This would be used if you had a web page, a web front end, that's issuing a bounds request and it wants data. But this time we want the data back in JSON, not in KML. So when I publish that to server, ultimately I get this, I'll just go to the server.
So just to be clear, Dean's kind of talking to web developers here at this point in a sense, because he's talking about how we can use an Inspire service to create a JSON service that can be used in a web application. A lot of web applications now use JSON as the main sort of data exchange protocol. You could almost say it's a format, I guess. But so it may seem like a bit of an obscure example, but we're kind of talking to web developers in a sense here now.
Yeah. So here, And then again, this looks a bit cryptic because you have trouble reading that, but all that is a URL. So any web page can compose that URL and say what those four numbers are for the extents. And in this case, I set max features to 10. And it sends that to that service, pulls back, that goes, and it sends another, it deciphers that URL and builds a WFS request, sends that to the airport's WFS service, and then fires back. So just to show what this is, I can show this in, you know, Notepad is a bunch of JSON, or I can pop it up in, I don't have a open layers thing set up, so I'll just pop it up in Data Inspector as GeoJSON. There you go. So those are the, so that's just basically the whole idea of, you can see how fairly simple it is to take, I've got a WMS overlay there, but to basically take those airports and serve them up, even though they are embedded within a an Inspire WFS service, I'm now making that accessible to, as Ken said, web developers. Yeah. And you can see all that that fairly rich attribute model has been preserved in that whole process. So I'm kind of running low on time here, so I'll just kind of wrap up, highlight what we were doing. So what's going on here? Well, we have an Inspire WFS that we're consuming with FME, and we're kind of mixing up products here. We started off with Data Inspector, and Ken and I both showed Workbench, which is the data transformation environment, and now I'm demoing FME Server, which is really our enterprise platform for producing services. And so that server is used to stage this broker service, which consumes the WFS and produces KML or JSON data streams. And then we also looked at a PDF example. And the last thing I wanted to highlight.
2 minutes.
2 minutes?
I gave you 5 extra minutes.
Yeah, well, I just wanted to highlight, because I don't have time to get into it too much, but yeah, FME can be, the main focus today was consuming data, and I just wanted to provide a footnote that, yes, not only can we consume it, but we can also produce. So FME can generate any kind of Inspire GML. We, of course, can generate all the raster coverages you might want. We can write out the metadata. And the big plus with FME is that once you've done it once, you can automate. And don't have time to get into this, but I did want to show this slide here because that demo I just showed, I think, is an example of eating your own dog food. I mentioned at the beginning, if you stand up services, I don't think it's a bad thing to be able to consume your own service, because then you're showing the discipline that you've actually produced something that's consumable. And so I'm just raising the issue here that a workspace is not just about translating or transforming data, but it can also be used to do messaging. So that workspace essentially becomes a message broker that can talk back and forth. And so the airport's WFS was actually also a workspace. And this is what that WFS workspace looks like. If anybody's curious about how to use FME to serve up WFS, I can talk to me later about that. So yeah, we'll just wrap up. I added one more arrow here. So the whole idea of that life cycle is once you publish data, you should be able to consume it again. So basically in terms of the life cycle that Ken mentioned, we support really all aspects of it. And the nice thing about FME is very modular. So it's not like a one size fits all or one big product suite. You have to buy FME and do everything FME. You can integrate FME with, you know, Degree, Esri, GeoServer, you name it, and it's very easy to fit a piece in. So wherever there is a gap in your information flow, wherever the pain point is, that's a good place to think about using FME. So it doesn't matter if it's reading or publishing or validating or sharing. And yeah, this is the eat your own dog food thing. So you should definitely test the services that you're standing up, make sure that they're useful. Talk to your users, so make sure you get to know your stakeholders. And definitely automating and make it easy to update and automate. That will help future-proof the investment that you're making in Inspire. Yeah, so yes, Inspire data and services can be really complicated, but with a little bit of help from FME, we're hopefully making it easier to transform it and making it accessible and shareable by everybody. So lots of resources online. If you don't have time to write any of this down, Google Inspire FME, you'll get all those links. That's the easiest. So thanks for coming. Any questions?
I do appreciate everybody joining the very first presentation of the conference. And, actually quite pleased to see how many people made it in, so thanks a lot for coming.
Yeah, I would be curious if, does anybody have, I don't know, what would be your, if anybody wants to volunteer, what's your biggest challenge that you're working with at the moment? Inspire data? Is it just finding data, or you have trouble reading it? Like what type? Integrating?
How many people are producers or suppliers, let's say, organizations that are supplying? So that's about half, yeah.
Okay. And then of the rest of you, how many people actually use Inspire data day to day? Not too many. So that could be why. So. But as, well, I guess we'll, that is partly why I've made the point that even the producers of data should invest in testing and making sure that what you are producing is easily consumable.
So we're, just to do a little bit of wrap up, we have a booth kind of in the back of the exhibition that starts tomorrow. The exhibition starts tomorrow. We're doing another FME presentation during the commercial track on Wednesday at 2 p.m. I'm also joining a customer of ours who's been using an extension of Inspire in Belgium towards a call before you dig application. So it's an interesting real-world use of the Inspire schema. That's on Friday at 9:30. So that's reducing excavation damage to subsoil infrastructure with Inspire. And on Friday, 3 p.m., the last presentation of the day, we're talking about delivering Inspire data through the Atom feed thing. Data interoperability, the
Inspire Solution Pack.
Inspire Solution Pack, when are you guys showing that?
I think on Wednesday,
2:30.
So you can see the Inspire Solution Pack. So that's an extension for FME that makes some of this complicated schema mapping a lot easier. Is that Benjamin?
Yeah.
So I guess we can wrap up. Thanks again for joining.
Yeah, we're here all week, as you heard. Ken, and none of you are allowed to go home until you see Ken's talk at the end. Well, thanks for coming. And like I said, we welcome your feedback. So. You can always send us an email or drop by the booth.